Hey everybody, Syntax77 here, and yes, I really am here, I promise. I know some of you may be wondering, where have I been? We're going to address that and a whole lot more in today's episode of...
Mail, mountains of it. It'll be a red letter day when the postman blows mail call.
You know, the show where I open packages and mail from viewers and people out there, but for the most part, it's really just an excuse for me to run my mouth about various topics which get brought up as I go through the mail, or at least that's what this is kind of turning into. First things first, those of you wondering where I've been, because it's been a couple weeks, at least over 2 weeks since my last video. Basically had two trips back to back that kind of made me pretty busy. The one that I got back from most recently was the annual deer camp video that we do up at the cabin in Tioga County, Pennsylvania. We do a video for that every year. I should say, actually, at this point, my dad does a video for that every year. I film a little bit and give him the footage, but it's 98% all his work. And that is posted right now. For those of you newer to the channel, no, it's not on this channel. It actually gets posted on my dad's channel. It's Whiterook85. I'll put a link up to it right here, and you can check that out if you're into hunting camps. We basically go every year and make a full video of our experience for the opening of buck season in Pennsylvania. So if you want to see what a little bit of cabin life is like, it's more cabin than it is hunting, even though we go for hunting season. It's a lot of good food, good times, good memories. You can check that out. If hunting isn't your thing, you know, that's fine. And if hunting really weirds you out, then probably skip that video. But that's a fun time, so check that out. It's out now. I know a lot of you wait all year for that. So good stuff. And then the thing I did before that was go to Iceland again, which I alluded to on my last mail call. And I've been working on the video for that. So I came back and I really started hitting the ground running with that. I have a rough cut of it done. I'm just working on making it really fun. But the four of us went there in a camper van this time instead of a hotel. And it was a fun time. I know some of the people on this channel, well, people watch this channel for all different reasons. I have travel videos, I have backpacking videos, is the bulk of my stuff. Those of you I know are out there that are only strictly hardcore into backpacking and you're not too big on the travel vids, that's fine. But you might want to give this one a chance when it comes out, because we did it, like I said, in a camper van. And no, we weren't backpacking and setting up tents, but we really got out there and got to see Iceland in a really different way than last time. It's a lot more just about the nature and the sights. Well, the first video had that too, but not really a lot of Reykjavik, except for last night when we went and you know, just got a shower and a quick rental. But other than that, we were just cruising around the van. It was really super cool. I think if I ever go back to Iceland, which I never thought I'd go more than once, at this point, I think I probably will go a third time. I don't know when, might skip a year, but I'd say the camper van is the way to go. It's a game changer. So awesome. You get to just drive wherever you want and see what you want. Now, I won't spoil the video too much, but just a little heads up. It was supposed to be a 5-day trip. Our flight got canceled. We sat around for 2 days not knowing if we were ever gonna, or even go at all, I should say. And we finally were able to get a flight, but we lost 2 days. So we crammed what was expected to be 5 days into 3 days and still somehow managed to do everything we wanted to do. So it's pretty crazy. We did go in November, which for somebody on the mid East Coast like me, it's pretty much was winter conditions, what we were driving in. So we had contingency plans and luckily it worked out for us. But when you watch that video, just know it's not necessarily the way that you would plan on purpose to see Iceland, and under the wrong conditions, it wouldn't be the safest way to do it, but it's what happened with us and it ended up being safe and fun. We got it done. So I'm looking forward to putting that video out, but yeah, that's where I've been. Now, back onto mail call, which, by the way, I gave you my interpretation of what mail call is, how we kind of have discussions like this in open mail. But hey, there's other opinions out there too. As a matter of fact, I want to incorporate more viewer comments into these videos as well, not just paper mail. So the first one, the inaugural one, if you will, is from a viewer about mail call itself. Let's find that. Username is just me. Interesting. I'm just going to call her Carol because she just seems like a Carol. And what does it say? I started watching YouTube, including your channel, as a novelty a year ago. But then I realized, why on earth do I want to sit on my butt watching other people have a life when I have my own life to live? Words of wisdom, Carol. Words of wisdom. How much of a pathetic loser Does it make a person to live vicariously through others? I don't know. I do it often myself, but I might be a loser. Plus, who on earth, capital E for earth, wants to watch a random stranger? Carol. Carol, I thought we were friends, but just let me just start over. Plus, who on earth wants to watch a random stranger do such mundane tasks such as opening mail? Can't really argue with that. OMG! Triple exclamation point. The only reason that I made this comment was I still get these notifications that I have no clue how to shut off. Well, Carol, you could have skipped all of the other stuff and just asked me how to shut them off. You just want to go to your YouTube settings under notifications. I'll send you a link. But yeah, you can turn that off. Let's see how she wraps it up here, though. For those watching YouTube videos, shut it off. Go do your own thing, because sooner or later you will die without doing anything but watching the lives of random strangers through the comforts of your home. And then a little sad face. Or even worse, what if you're homeless and watching YouTube vicariously? Dire straits, rough times. Carol, you make a good point. Shut this crap off and live your own life. So there's another perspective on what the Mail Call It show is, but I like to think we kind of make it fun. So I get letters that are sticker requests. Sometimes they have notes in them that bring up topics. And then this time I actually got some sort of package here. Let's see what Mike here has to say. Letter for a sticker. Thank you for all the wonderful trip videos and other content you've produced for many years. I finally caught up with all your longer trip videos, but I've truly enjoyed each and every one. Yeah, for those of you new viewers out there, well, I'll get into it in a little bit, but I have playlists, and I know I don't come out with these hiking videos all the time because A, I have to go hiking, I have to actually do a trip, and then B, I put a lot of time into editing them to try to make them more of a short film than just a stitched together series of clips. It's just what makes it interesting for me personally to make the videos, so they don't come out that often. Long story short is, I got playlists for you new viewers. Hit the back catalog. There's a lot of good stuff in there. There's over 50 to 60 of those trip videos that are average like an hour a piece. So there's plenty of content there. If I could send you a cheeseburger, I would. But instead, I'll send the recommendation you try a garbage grinder. A garbage grinder is ham, bacon, fried egg, and other fixings on top of a classic cheeseburger platform. It's truly a well-balanced meal. Anybody else heard of a garbage grinder? Sounds good. I'm going to have to try that out. I do like those post-hike cheeseburgers. And a lot of people also ask or complain sometimes that I don't show the cheeseburger at the end of the video. Sorry, maybe one day. Maybe it's a MacGuffin. I don't know. All right, next up. Love your videos. A lot of great tips from you. That's from Noah. Sticker on the way, buddy. This person sent me a sticker. That's always fun. Two Bob's Adventures. Thanks, Two Bob's. And the Two Bob's are Bob, who wrote this letter. He's 13 years old, and his dad is Bob as well. They watch the videos together, and we got stickers made for our channel. They're from Illinois. Saw your Red River Gorge video. Went there once and are hoping to go again soon. Thanks, and we're looking forward to more videos. Thank you, Two Bob's. Sticker on the way. Red River Gorge was a great trip. Been there twice now, and I would love to go a third time. It's kind of hard to choose. I like revisiting places, and I also like seeing new places. Stuff. Love all your videos. I've been watching them. Hope you have a sticker. No problem, Lair. Let's see this one here. This is from Kaylin. And Kaylin, I'm assuming, is one of my younger viewers. Made some great artwork for me. On the back, it says a little color for your sticker board right there. And some cool artwork. It's almost like a postcard. So thank you, Kaylin. And actually, there's another one from Kaylin as well. They postmarked around the same time. It's from November. Oh, I hope you didn't think that I didn't get it. I will be honest. A lot of times I go on a trip, I come back, I check the mailbox. It's not like every day I check it. So it might be a little slow for me checking these things, especially with what I have going on lately. You made me another sticker, so thank you, Kaylin. I hope you didn't think I didn't get the first one, but I'll give you some major credit right now. These are two separate hand-drawn pictures, and your ability to make the same artwork nearly identical twice is pretty impressive. Well done. Much appreciated. All right, this one is a thicker one. And then we'll open the box. Actually, I should read some comments too. I guess we'll just get all the paper mail out of the way. Ooh, what's in here? This looks like it may be a company. EDCpacks.com. It looks like you just got a shout out there. That's like a patch. Put that on my hat. I see what you're going for, probably. Let's see what it is. What is EDC Packs? Everyday Carry is what I know EDC as. My name is JR and I started EDCpacks.com as a way to put all the things I loved about camping, survival, and preparedness in one place. Things have grown more than I expected. I found your profile online, wanted to send you a small gift just to say thanks for the awesome content. Well, you're welcome, JR. Now I got to check out EDCpacks.com. See what you guys make. It worked. You got me interested. Speaking of EDC, everyday carry, some people asked in the last video or two videos ago, do you carry a knife everyday, Syntax? Of course I do. Knife, flashlight, gun, every day. I don't know why you ask. Now, next up, let's open this parcel. Hold on, tape. Maybe the other side will work. That actually didn't help. Hold on. All right. What do we got here? Two items. This is in a fancy carrying bag. Now I'll admit, I caught a glimpse of that email before I realized that I should save it for the video. And I did see it was some sort of hiking pole. I couldn't tell if it was like a winter hiking pole or ultralight, like summer hiking pole. There isn't a note in here, so I'm just gonna check it out. The stuff on here says Vertex Carbon Poles by CNOC Outdoors. And it's come up on the channel numerous times. I have whole specific videos about it. Syntax, do you use hiking poles or trekking poles? Or sometimes they'll see that I don't use them and they'll say, why don't you like them? And I've addressed it before, but I do like trekking poles. But when I'm filming, it's just too much going on. But I advise people to at least try them, especially if you have knee pain or if you're on trails where things are a little unsteady. They can really save your butt. Personally, I don't get a chance to use them too much, like I said, because of the filming, but I do like to check them out. I did a video before on one called like Hiking Bear that were pretty affordable. I don't know the price on these, but they feel super light. Matter of fact, I should weigh one of these. I have the scale right over there. So I don't know what I'm doing, do I? Ah, I see. When I pull this, this wire is running through it, and now it just, oh, so I just keep pulling and it locks in. It's pretty light. I should check that out. Hold on. All right, I'm back. I just got my scale off camera there, but you're just gonna have to trust me. It was 8 ounces for the pole by itself and 8.5 ounces with the snow basket on there. And I didn't measure it, but I'm imagining like a little over 8 ounces with this smaller basket that you can put on the tip. So it does have a snow basket for winter use. Now, winter is the one time where even when filming, I'd still bring trekking poles, because for snowshoeing in tough spots, these can really reduce, in my opinion, fatigue and save you from going down in some of those slippery or heavy snow situations. So thank you guys. I like this. I like the poles that actually fold down like this, because they're so much more stowable. I have a pair over there somewhere of some black diamond ones, which are quite expensive, but I invested in them and they're nice. They kind of break down similar. I'll have to compare the weight on those to this and the price, of course, but these feel pretty good. Now, of course, you really find out about these hiking poles when you're on the trail pounding them. A lot of times the biggest point of failure is what kind of material they put in the handles. I've gotten some cheaper ones with cork, and the cork has broken down and started to flake off after a couple seasons of use. But they're also like $15 a pole instead of like $180 for a set or something crazy, like my black diamonds were, or the $150 was something nuts. So I wouldn't expect that from a higher end pole, but you know, it's one of those things that you weigh out depending on how much you hike. Feel free guys too to let me know your opinions on hiking poles and the budget ones versus the higher end ones. But these are interesting. Vertex carbon, so obviously that would be like a carbon fiber going on here, which is probably why it's achieving that light weight. They feel pretty good, And they now let's see how it breaks down. Oh, look, here's a clip. Ah, so I'm still adjustable at the top here. You get about 40 centimeters, it looks like, of adjustable space there. And then how do I take them apart? Uh-oh, don't break anything, Sean. Oh, there's a little metal pin here. Looks like I just released the pressure and now everything is able to come apart. I actually like that. And then there's a little piece of Velcro here, like a Velcro strap, and it holds it in place. All right, I will test these out further, but there's a look at the Vertex Carbon hiking poles by CNOC or CNOC. And this looks like perhaps a water container. I wonder if I can use this with my Katadyn B3. Probably not, because of the wide mouth, as a dirty water bottle, but the flow of clean water coming out is a standard thread like this size. So looks like now I have another potential water bag. Although, you know what I'm noticing? Look at the end of this thing. It clips open almost like I have like a dry bag for my cell phone. It's kind of similar to this. So it looks like you can open the whole top up somehow without breaking it. Ah, it slides to the side. All right, so don't lose that. Slide that out of the way. Now this just opens up. And actually, now I'm thinking this would be awesome, not with the Katadyn because of the thread size I was talking about, but as a dirty water bag, this would probably be really quick and easy to scoop up some water, fill it, clip it back down, and squeeze it. Now, that would work with my Sawyer squeeze, because I recently got this, if you remember from my abandoned Air Force Base video that I posted last month for Halloween. I got this Sawyer S3, which is heavy duty, like chemical removal. You wouldn't always need something like that, but it came with on the tip a secondary stage filter, which is basically it's called a Sawyer Mini, or I'm sorry, it's actually called a Sawyer Micro because it's even smaller than the Sawyer Mini. So that I could plug on here, at least from first glance. I have a quick fill. These threads look different than the Sawyer. And the Sawyer, as far as I know, has, well, oh, wait, no, never mind. Don't listen to me. Too early in the day, and it's like noon. But there you go. So I can test that out too. A little water bag, feels pretty light. Probably like an ounce, right? Yeah, nice. All right, thank you, CNOC. Some more gear to check out. Just another topic to bring up. You guys like gravity systems out there, where you bring bags like this and set up a gravity system for your water filter, or do you just like single systems, as I struggle to figure this out? There we go. Where you just kind of squeeze by hand just what you need, which on solar trips is what I've been really coming to like with the Katadyn B3 system, where it's just a little half liter, 0.6 liter bag. But it's so quick to filter that I just scoop up and drink right out of it. And if I need stockpile water, I can squeeze into another bottle. It works pretty well. But for group trips, gravity filters are pretty cool, at least in my opinion. But different strokes for different folks, right? All right, so that's that. So that covers, I believe, all the mail. Yeah. So the next thing would be, I'm just going to spin through viewer comments. So we left off last time with Carol, who I responded to quite simply with, right on, Carol. Why? Like I said, just because she was acting like Carol. There's a story to that, but we can save that for another episode. But from now on, I think I'm just going to respond to people who are a little over the top as Carol. I'll spin through these. Maybe it'll spur some conversation. Speaking of water bottle storage, etc., my backpacking water storage video, I use a reservoir for convenience and like how the water stays insulated from the air temperature in my bag. So refreshing to get a mouthful of cold water on a hot hike. There you go. That guy likes cold water. All right. They're not all going to spur huge conversations, but there you go. Here's one that I just got. It was edited, so he put some thought into this. I'm just going to call him Michael L., even though everybody seems to put their full name on the internet now. I'm just going to call you Michael L. On my Taste of the Appalachian Trail video, hiking and hammock camping. What you got, Michael? The way you try to explain shit is just horrendous. I'm glad I already knew what you were talking about at minute 44 and 47 seconds. Ugh. Otherwise, I'd still be lost. I have to take a look and see what's going on. In that video, I don't know what I was talking about. You're welcome for the view. Thank you. On your video, but sorry, man. I just can't stand the sound of your voice. All right. Well, all this time, Here I was thinking that looks may not be my strong point, but at least I can run my mouth. Now it doesn't seem like I have much to go on at all. What will I do, Michael? I gotta look at this video and see what was I talking about at 44 minutes that I was really bad at explaining. Hold on. Taste of the Appalachian Trail. 44 minutes and 47 seconds. Ugh. Ads. Ridiculous.
Wife Sarah over there checking out for loosening or taking it down and then sliding up here.
And again, this is another thing that in a lighter weight system could be tweaked. But full climbing grade, I would assume, or a pretty heavy grade carabiner. Although they do make sure to tell you that it should come straight through it. You shouldn't be actually hanging pressure off of the end of it. It's just there to kind of keep it snug to the tree. It's got a little extra piece of strap, wide strap there to protect the tree. And they went carabiner style on the tarp guy line. All right, so yeah, a little early in the morning when I shot that, I stuttering a little bit, I don't know. Maybe I just assumed that people had seen systems like that before and knew what I was talking about, but sorry, buddy. Maybe it was just the sound of my voice. Maybe there's no way I could have won Michael over. But I think I was trying to say, same as like Dutch clips, when you have something that holds your line, your strap for your suspension around the tree, you don't want to have a hard angle coming off of it because you're putting a lot of undue pressure on there. You just want to use the clip or the carabiner to kind of keep the strap guided, but you don't want to put pressure on it. There. Not that Michael's watching. I think he's done with me. Anyway, let's go back to some other comments. I'm a little nervous now. I'm trying to keep it positive. Although all the letters I received have been polite and nice, so that's good. Someone on winter camping with a sled. Another fun winter video now that winter's here, if you haven't seen that. He said, sub? That's a hoagie. Yeah, we're a little south of Philly. We're in Delaware, so we're kind of weird, Mike and I. Sometimes we say sub. Very rarely I say hoagie. It's in my lexicon, but typically I say sub. I'm talking about sandwiches right now, of course. We brought a sandwich on that trip for day one. It was a little frozen by the time we ate it, but it was good. I always like to do that. Not always. Mike and I do that a lot on backpacking trips. I'm sure a lot of you guys and gals out there do this too. If not, it's a fun thing that I actually, for my first couple of years, never really thought about. But on day one, bring something fun for lunch or even dinner. Especially on winter trips, you can bring stuff for several days in, like steaks and stuff. But even if it's fair weather, you can pack in a sub. It's not the lightest thing in the world if you're trying to cover a lot of mileage. But in the case of that trip and a lot of trips that Mike and I do in the winter, we're just slugging in. It's painful, but we do lower mileage and a ton of weight. And then when we get to camp, we have fun. So on that one, we brought in like a whole hoagie. Yeah, pretty fun. Sometimes he makes wraps, stuff like that. We like food on our trips. Someone just says, thanks, bro, for the winter ultralight backpacking gear list video. Winter videos are picking up. Yeah, I did a whole separate video on ultralight backpacking gear list specifically for winter, I guess last season. So if you are into that, feel free to check that out. I have my ultralight backpacking gear list for 3-season as well, which you can check out, but this one was specifically for winter. So obviously it's heavier, but it's still, in my opinion, weight conscious enough that I called it that. Where did you get the trail map for my Pemi Loop video? I get these questions a lot. I'll have to go back and look at the video. I can't remember all these different trail maps a lot of times they've used over the years. But most of the time, and what they probably are referring to is I just go online and Google image search. And eventually I usually find a picture, whether it's from the National Forest Service or National Park Service, or it's just, I don't know where these things come from. But you can find images out there and you just print it out and then you can put it in a plastic like Ziploc bag. Keep it safe and dry, and boom, there you go. You got a map for your trip right there. Didn't have to search for it or order it. This one's actually a good talking point. Paul says on my last mail call video, what's going on? Haven't seen any hiking videos that I used to enjoy so much. Have you given up on those solo hikes in the White Mountains of New Hampshire? In Paul's case, he may be specifically saying he wants a solo hike video of me in the White Mountains, which I have not done in a little while. The closest I came was the video I was just talking about with Mike, which was last February. We did a winter trip up there, but it wasn't solo. So maybe he specifically wants that. But other than Paul, I get a lot of comments from people saying, what's going on? How come you don't do hiking videos anymore? And it's confusing because I've put out more hiking videos this year than I believe ever before. Maybe people are tuning into the channel. I do put out more content now and a more variety of it, like these videos right here. So maybe people are tuning into the channel, looking at the feed, not seeing in the last three or four videos a hiking video and thinking I don't put them out anymore. But dig a little deeper. They're there. In the past, I didn't put nearly as much time into these videos. I just couldn't. So all I would do was like every few months or twice a year put up a hiking video, and now I'm able to put out a lot more. So my advice to you is, if you, of course, this type of person probably hasn't made it this far into this video, but if you're still hanging in there and you happen to have stumbled upon this one, if you just want those hiking videos, just check the channel every once in a while and scroll down a little bit, and I have a whole playlist, little shelf there, that is just hiking and backpacking videos, overnight trips, etc. If you want specifically hammock camping videos, I got a separate one underneath for that. If you want just winter videos, got a separate one for that. You get the point. But I've got the playlist, they're there, so check them out. And then another thing is, YouTube has really changed the way that they are pushing videos to people. They're trying a lot of different stuff, and things have definitely changed. I've noticed it with channels that I follow. They've switched to a format as far as like the suggested videos when you first open your homepage and stuff like that, pushing content to you of all kinds of people, regardless of whether or not you're subscribed, which is cool for finding new content. But if you're trying to specifically follow somebody like I do with some of my channels, I find I'm missing stuff. So maybe that's happening too. The way around that nowadays is, it's almost like you got to subscribe twice. There's the subscribe button, right? Probably around here or something. You're already subscribed, but And you'll get random pushes to your like phone and stuff if a video's out sometimes, and they choose that based on algorithms. But next to that subscribe button, there's a little bell. That's what you got to do for your favorite channels now. That's what I do. You hit that bell, and then you will get a notification for every video that comes out, and you'll know when I post. And if it's a video you're not into, like a mail call video about knives, then you can skip it. If it's a feature length backpacking video, then you can go, oh, cool. At least you'll know what's going on. So hit that bell if you want to be in the loop. Maybe that's what's going on, because to Paul W. and anybody else out there, just posted, no, I say just, but it was a month or two ago, my wife and I went to the Adirondacks. And then before that, two solo videos with me down south. Now for Paul, that's not up in the White Mountains, but for other people out there, check them out. All right, winter camping with a sled. I'm cracking up at how well thought out the beer situation was. That definitely got my subscribe. Yeah, we put a lot of thought into the beer. I should say Mike put a lot of thought into the beer on that trip. You can watch the video, but basically because it was so cold out, we had certain beers that were lower proof and certain ones that were higher proof. The higher the proof on a alcohol, the slower it is to freeze, or it may never freeze at all, depending how strong it is. In the case of beer, all of it's going to freeze eventually, but it's a little slower, so we had to drink in order of proof so that our beer didn't explode over the course of a three-day trip, because we like to have a couple beers at night with our steaks. This is on hiking the Grayson Highlands. We'll do a few more of these. Sorry to get personal, but the ponies respond much better to someone in a penguin's hat. Something I noticed. Darren H., sorry to offend you. I don't have a penguin's hat, but I'm much closer to Philly than I am Pittsburgh, so I might get beat up around here for wearing that penguin's hat. Gotta wear flyers. Last one we'll do. Last two. Ever find a 2-liter bag for it? This is on the Katadyn B-Free water filter review video, where at first I said I wanted to find a larger bag. Remember I was talking before about that half-liter system? I did find one. I believe I updated the video with a link in the description of that original review. I found a 2-liter, it's right here, 2-liter bag. They also make it in 3-liter, and it's by Hydropack, and it's got that same wide mouth threading that the stock bag has on, here's the Katadyn B-Free. Matter of fact, if I was a little smarter, I would have paid attention to that and noticed that Hydropack actually presumably custom made for them this 0.6-liter one that comes with the B-Free system. So, therefore, the Hydropack bags definitely work, the wide mouth ones. So yeah, man, they're out there and you can buy them. I forget how much that cost me. Under 20, I think it was about the same price for 2 or 3-liter. It's just up to how much water versus the weight of the bag you want to carry. And then there actually is one that's interesting here, a tip for winter hikers. This is on my winter hammock camping in the Adirondacks video, where I solo trip went and did some snowshoeing and hammock camping in the winter. It was my first experience with cold weather snow hammock camping. It was a really fun video if you haven't seen it. But he says, a tip for winter hikers, don't walk in ski tracks if possible. And then in parentheses, he says lake scene, because I walked across, I was able to snowshoe across. There's a big bed of snow on it, snowshoe across a lake to circumvent some of the trail mileage I was going to do. And it was just fun. But he says, don't walk in ski tracks if possible. It may be so that the skier plans for a quick return in tracks he made before and now has to track again. That is a great point. And I will own up to that. I didn't think of that at the time, and I may not have thought of it again, to be perfectly honest. But this is from Fretless. Fretless, thank you for a good tip. So basically he's saying, you know, when I walk in the snowshoes, I may not be post-holing quite as bad, not nearly as bad, which is why they're required in the Adirondacks. I'm not tearing up the trail as bad as walking with my boots, but I am still kind of tamping it down and making it uneven for sure. So a skier has those smooth tracks, and on the way back, they're probably cursing whoever came along and ruined their trail. I don't know. That's a good point. So in the future, I will try to walk to the side of those if it's a big open area. If it's a little narrow monorail, I'm going to have to do what I got to do. And a monorail is basically if you're ever walking on a trail in the snow and it seems like you're only on, like, you know, your boots are only going in a few inches, it's all good, right? You step off to the side, maybe to answer nature's call or just explore, or you just go off course and all of a sudden you're up to your waist in snow. And what happened was, underneath of that surface soft snow, there's actually what they call a monorail, and it's just like a whole season, picture like a month's worth of people trampling on this trail, this narrow corridor of snow, and it's packing it down and it's turning into ice, and it's nice and firm. Off to the sides where nobody normally walks, it's still powder, and you fall right off. So that's a little tip for you too. Stay on the monorail, tread lightly when you leave the trail on snowshoeing trips, or I should say trips where you should be snowshoeing, but they're on your pack because you think that the trail's nice and packed. That's what usually happens to me, and then I go off and really wish I had my snowshoes because I'm up to my waist in snow. That happened to Mike and I a ton on the video. If you look up High Winds Hiking, just search that, winter backpacking trip, High Winds Hiking. We got hit by like 80 mile per hour winds. It was 100 miles per hour on the summit of Washington. So where we were on our peaks, which was only like a half mile away, it was definitely like 80 miles an hour. We got knocked all over the place. That's not really the point, but that's why that video was fun. But we were driven crazy once we got down into the lower elevations below treeline by that very thing. Every time we tried to search around, even with snowshoes, I had some cheaper ones back then, I was kind of almost post-holing with the snowshoes, and then I'd lift my foot up and they'd come off, or I'd try to walk without them, and I was anyway, check the video out. It was fun in the long run. It was fun. All right. That kind of covers comments because I'm going pretty long here and I'm probably going to fill my card up pretty soon. That's about all I got. So thanks for joining me on this edition of Mail Call. Don't forget, if you want to check out that hunting video over on my dad's channel, feel free to check that out. Stay tuned for the Iceland video that is coming. That's why I'm kind of putting out these topical videos for now, because I'm busy editing that. And yeah, thanks for joining me. And to all my lovely subscribers out there, you're the best. Till next time, I'm Syntax77, and you have fun out there. Your ability to make the same artwork nearly identical twice is pretty. What? He didn't even go backpacking in his video. Thumb it down, bro. Right on, Carol. Watch this.